Hey everyone, we're at the end of workbook one, but we're not done yet. In our last video, we learned how to play the E7 chord and find some ways that it fits in with the chords that we know so far. But in this video, we're going to take a look at what happens when a chord simply doesn't fit within a key, and how to describe that. Before we do that, however, we're going to put together a few chord progressions so we can have a good example to work with.
To recap, the chords we've learned so far are C, A minor, and G, our sticker chords, F and D minor, which can be made by adding fingers to A minor, E minor, which I like to call the diagonally chord, and E7, which we've already discussed has some unusual elements to it, but fits in nicely in the key of A minor. For our next song, we'll use just about all of these chords, except one. We don't need E minor just yet, so let's set it aside for when we do.
With these tools in our toolbox, let's start piecing together a song. And because you've worked so hard thus far, we're going to start easy. Recalling our verse progression for My Girl, we're going to use that pattern again. C, F, C, F.
In My Girl, we played this pretty slowly, with two half-note strums per chord. But now we're going to speed up our strumming just a little by changing it to four quarter-note strums per chord.
I'd like you to try this, too. I hinted at it when we played Pachelbel's Canon, but now I'll say that this is the preferred method to play a song like this. Don't strum down on every beat. That makes it sound like you're in too much of a hurry and it's too harsh. Instead, try strumming down and then up. Then you can put a little accent on the down strums, and it sounds more interesting, like this. Let's try doing that with this pattern, and we'll play it twice through. Ready? One, two, three, four. One, two. The only tricky thing in this part is getting used to the down, up strumming. And once you get the hang of that, it's very natural and even kind of easier. So, with this accomplished, let's challenge ourselves a little further.
For this section, we're returning back to having multiple chords in one measure, but you know what this means. We need to divide the strums between the chords. And here's some good news. We can apply the tricks we learned about changing between A minor, F, and D minor, since that's exactly what we're doing here. Start with two fingers on the F chord, then change to one for A minor, then go to three for D minor, and back to two for F again. Lastly, we come to two bars of G and only G. Since we're doing four beats per measure, quarter note strum, that means eight strums of G. But don't forget to keep doing the down-up pattern.
We're not going to do any repeats in this section, so play it once through, slowly, with me. Ready?
One, two, three, and one, two.
Nice work. This section won't be too hard if you just remember how all of those chords are similar and give it a little practice. So let's move on to our final section where we get to bring back our new chord, E7.
First, you basically have to change between the same four chords a few times. If you can play the first two measures, then you can play the next two measures, and the next two, and honestly, you can easily play the last two since that final measure ends on C and the E7 chord is taken out. So, let's start simply with only those two initial measures. We're going from F to G to C and then to E7. E7 is going to be really the only thing here that might trip you up since it's new. The rest of these chords, we've got a ton of experience with. So let's try these two measures slowly, remembering the down-up strum, two strums per chord. Ready? One, two, three, and. One, two, three. Good. Now let's add the other measures, which essentially amounts to us just repeating the first two measures a lot. Play this with me. Ready? One, two, three, and. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three.
Now that we have these three sections, we're about ready to sort them and attach them to a song. We're going to come back to our E7 section in a little bit, but let's play the song first. And to do that, we're going to revisit one of the bands we've covered and focus on one of its individual members. From the Beatles, we're looking at the solo work of John Lennon.
We've already learned a little bit about the Beatles, where they're from, when they were formed, their popularity and impact on music, and their record sales. But if you recall, I said there were two primary songwriters in the Beatles, Paul McCartney and John Lennon. Look at the credits for the vast majority of their work, and you'll see this. But as often happens in situations where you have a number of strong-willed and creative people, the Beatles couldn't last forever. With all four members wanting to pursue other interests and projects, they broke up in 1970, and the songwriting partnership of Lennon-McCartney was no more.
Neither suffered too badly, though. All four of the Beatles went on to have successful solo careers, with Paul McCartney forming a new band called Wings, George Harrison emerging as a stronger songwriter than many had given him credit for, Ringo Starr becoming an in-demand studio musician, and John Lennon continuing to produce music and art with his wife Yoko Ono. But, as might be expected, Lennon and McCartney's solo work still stood out among the rest.
In 1969, Lennon started the Plastic Ono Band with Yoko Ono, and they released their first album in 1970, the same year the Beatles officially disbanded. It did well commercially and with critics, but it was Lennon's second solo album, Imagine, released in 1971, that would prove to be his biggest commercial success, with its title track becoming his best-selling single post-Beatles.
Lennon was a vocal opponent of war, the Vietnam War in particular, violence, poverty, and a strong advocate for women's rights and fair treatment of workers. In Imagine, he asks us to picture a world where human beings could put aside the things that divide us and try to live in peace.
With lyrics inspired by a poem called Cloud Peace from his wife's 1964 book Grapefruit, Imagine has continued to resonate with people today. BMI, who tracks how often songs are used, called it one of the 100 most performed songs of the 20th century, and in 1999, the Recording Industry Association of America ranked it as number 30 out of 365 of the best songs of the century. In 2004, Rolling Stone magazine ranked it number 3 of the 500 greatest songs of all time, and it has been played for New Year's Eve in Times Square every year since 2005.
Now it's our turn. Let's arrange these sections into a solid song and see if we can play along with a former Beatle.
First, we need labels for the three sections. The C and F section will be the verse. The A minor F D minor section will be our chorus, and the E7 section will be the bridge. Now we just need the form. Wait for four measures while the piano intro starts the song, then begin with the verse, then chorus, then verse, and chorus again. Then we go to the bridge. And after that, it's easy. Verse, chorus, bridge. And don't forget, keep the down-up strum going the whole time.
Let's do it. Ready?
No hell below us.
Nicely done, everyone. And now, just like we did with Fur Elise, let's take a closer look at something. Our mysterious E7 chord. We saw how Beethoven used it in a minor key, but let's see what John Lennon is up to.
First of all, can we determine what key Imagine is in? Well, these are two good hints. It starts with a C chord and ends with a C chord. And does that final C chord give us a feeling of resolution? I think it does. Not to mention, if you look at all of the chords in this song, they are all chords we can label in the key of C. Except, of course, for one glaring exception. So what does this all tell us? We can confidently say that this song is in the key of C. These chords all fit in, and C clearly sounds like our one chord. But that leaves some confusion about E7. It doesn't belong in the E spot because it's not minor, but it's also not a 5 chord. That's G. So, where does it go? Well, that's the thing. It's not in our key. We would refer to this as an outside chord.
Chords and notes that fit within any given key have a name. They're called diatonic. But that still leaves out a lot of notes and chords, so are we not allowed to use them? Not exactly. Done correctly, outside chords can add something special to a song, and John Lennon found a good place for one in the bridge to Imagine.
Imagine that instead of using an E7 here, Lennon just stayed on that C chord. Let's try playing that through four measures just to see. Ready? One, two, three, and one. Sounds perfectly fine and would probably fit in okay with the song, but that E7 being outside of the key of C offers something unique. Our ears don't really expect it and it grabs our attention for a second. Let's add an E7 back in to hear the difference. Ready? One, two, three, and one. Gives us that extra little something, like an unexpected spice in food.
You can't just use any outside chords anywhere you please. Sometimes things just sound plain wrong. To decide what works is part musical rules and part taste, so they're a little tricky. But when they work, they sound really cool.
Another example we can use, if we go back in time, is Sheena is a Punk Rocker. Remember the trick chord we learned just for that song? Well, this is also in the key of C. So technically, there's no B-flat chord. But throw it in here after these measures of G. Again, it grabs our attention. Let's try a whole new progression. Start with a measure of C, then a measure of E minor, then two measures of G. We're going to start off with one strum per chord, but we're also going to count in a fast 4. Now don't let this scare you, it's not too hard with only one strum. Let's try it. Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, now let's add a little more to it. Two measures of F, then two more measures of C. Resolves nicely, right? Well, let's go further. Add two more measures of F. And now we're going to throw that outside chord in here, two measures of E7. Then from E7, we'll do two measures of A minor, because A minor sounds good with E7, and then go from A minor to F. We haven't resolved to C yet, but we'll stop here just for now.
Did you catch how E7 bends our ear a little bit? It's kind of a cool, unexpected twist in an otherwise straightforward series of chords. I like it. And there's a little more we can do to mess around with this.
Let's just take the first measure, C. We were playing one strum with a quick underlying beat, but now let's match our strumming to that beat. Four quick strums. Ready? One, two, three, and. Simple so far. But now it's time to try something new with our rhythm. Replace the first beat and the third beat with rests, so you're only playing on beats 2 and 4. Try that with me. 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, 4.
If you turn on the radio and listen to practically any song, you'll find that there's a strong emphasis on beats 2 and 4. This is the heartbeat of pop, rock, blues, jazz, hip-hop, even country music. We haven't been singling out the 2 and the 4, so it could be easier for you to count. But now you're ready, and we're adding it to our final song.
We're also making one last change. Instead of rest, strum, rest, strum, we're going to take that first quarter note beat and change it into 2 8-th notes. So this measure of C would sound like this. Shh. What happens if we apply this to the entire progression I just showed you? Well, let's slow it down just a smidge and find out. Ready? 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Once you get the hang of this, as with so many other things, it's not too hard and even becomes second nature. Now, something to consider is that since nearly every chord repeats, you have a little time to prep yourself. The exception is the first two measures, C to E minor. But you can get that with some practice. From there on, you know that every chord will happen twice. Also, to make life easier for yourself, let's apply some of that down-up strumming we were doing with Imagine. Play the eighth notes down-up, and play the single quarter note down. Now, let's add two more sections.
The next section isn't too terribly different. It starts again with C to E minor, and from there it's pretty easy. First 8 bars are exactly the same as our first section, and then we have some simple variations, a few more measures at the end, and no E7 chord this time. Let's try this with our new strum pattern. Ready? 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Our last section, you don't even really need a chart. We're going to apply this to the pop chord progression. In keeping with the spirit of the rest of the song, we'll do each chord twice, but other than that, it's the C, G, A minor, F, or 1, 5, 6, 4 progression that you've come to love. Try it with me twice through. Ready? 1, 2, 3, and 1. One more time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4,
section is not only our intro, but also our outro, so let's note that. The second section will be our verse, and the third section will be our bridge. The song form will go like this. After 10 measures of introduction, we have our intro, two verses, bridge, verse, bridge, verse, and then end with our first section again, this time as an outro.
and we're almost ready to play this. But first, as always, some background. This song is going to be unique among all the songs we've done so far, as we are actually going to be playing with another ukulele player. If you're familiar with only one song that features ukulele, chances are that it's this one, Somewhere Over the Rainbow, as performed by Israel Kamakawiwo’ole.
Israel Kamakawiwo’ole, also known as Iz, was born in Honolulu, Hawaii in 1959. He was drawn to music at a young age, listening to famous performers such as Peter Moon and Don Ho, and playing music with his brother Skippy at age 11. Music was already in Iz's blood. His uncle was famed ukulele virtuoso Mo Keale. In 1976, Iz formed the Makaha Sons of Niihau with Skippy, Louis Kauakahi, Sam Gray, and Jerome Coco. The band focused on playing traditional Hawaiian music and became popular throughout the islands. Unfortunately, Skippy passed away in 1982 due to health problems, but the band continued on and achieved even more acclaim with the breakthrough albums Puana Hau Mike Aloha in 1984 and Ho'ola in 1986. 1991's Ho'olu Ana would mark the last time Iz would record with the group, and he left in 1993 to focus on his solo career. But it was something he recorded 5 years earlier in 1988 that would eventually bring him to the attention of the world.
Picture this. It's 3 in the morning. You're a recording engineer. You've had a long day of recording some pop acts that you're really not very inspired by, and you want to go home. This was the mindset of Milan Bertosa when he got a call from a client of his, saying he had a friend who wanted to make a demo of something really quick. After talking with this friend on the phone for a few minutes, Bertosa was impressed with how kind and sweet-natured this guy seemed. So he gave the stranger 15 minutes to get to the studio and do his thing. 15 minutes later, in walked, as he described, the biggest human being he'd ever seen in his life.
Iz, standing 6'1" and weighing about 500 pounds, showed up with his ukulele. Bertosa found him a chair, set up some microphones, did a sound check, and then let the tape roll. And Iz proceeded to sing a medley of Somewhere Over the Rainbow from The Wizard of Oz, followed by What a Wonderful World by Louis Armstrong. One take, and it was done.
At the time, Bertosa gave a copy to Iz and kept the original recording for himself, but he found himself showing it to people whenever he got the chance, and who he showed it to in 1993 was pretty significant.
Bertosa had started working at the Mountain Apple Company, a recording studio in Honolulu that was producing Iz's first solo record. As the record neared completion, Bertosa showed producer John DeMello the recording of the Somewhere Over the Rainbow, What a Wonderful World medley. They included it on the album that would be called Facing Future, and largely based on the strength of Somewhere Over the Rainbow, it became the best-selling Hawaiian album of all time.
Because of his size, Iz had many of the same health problems his brother had, and eventually succumbed to them in 1997, at age 38. By that time, he was already one of Hawaii's most beloved performers, but Somewhere Over the Rainbow was just starting to bring him fame across the mainland United States and around the world.
His body lay in state at Hawaii's Capitol building, meaning people could come and pay their respects, and this was an honor usually reserved for presidents, politicians, and world leaders. He was then cremated and his ashes were spread in the Pacific Ocean, as thousands of people attended, mourning his passing but celebrating the music he had given them.
And now we get to play along with him. So, at first, wait 10 measures as Iz brings us into the song. Then, as he starts to sing, we start to play. Don't forget, we don't play on the first beat, only on the 2 and 4. But don't worry if you miss it. Just try to sync up with me, and remember that you can do this as many times as you like. Ready, everyone? Thank you. Very good work, everyone. And now, with our seven chords, knowledge of various chord progressions, the key of C, different song forms, and a lot of fun facts about a lot of different artists, we come to the end of the ukulele workbook number one videos. Well done for making it this far, and I hope you want to continue. As we proceed, I've still got more songs for us to play, more artists for us to learn about, and some new keys where our knowledge of Roman numerals will really start to be put to good use. And I hope you stick around for that. But until then, thank you for watching, everybody.